Welcome, everyone. How wonderful to be together today in one mountain at many paths, where our mission is what Barbara Marx Hubbard and Dr. Marc Gafni call a planetary awakening in love through unique self symphony. We are activating a new humanity, and we are awakening as a new species, Homo Amor, the fulfillment of Homo sapiens. As a church, synagogue, a mosque, a temple, a zendo, no one is excluded, everyone is included, and we come together to attune to the evolutionary impulse awakening within us. I am Kristina Tahel, the co-executive producer, along with Krista Josefa, Jacqueline Clark, and Jamie Long. And we are so delighted to be together with each and every one of you today for week 285 of our live community broadcast. What a privilege it is to be part of a global community where we contribute to humanity's awakening. Use the Zoom and Facebook chat functions to say hello, to let us know where you're from, to resonate the Dharma, and to speak your prayers. On Zoom, do check that your chat settings say everyone so that we can all hear from you. Sign up for and read our weekly emails. There you find our replays, our community activities, featured videos, volunteer opportunities, celebrations, surprise, and inspiration. Care to step into the work and the holy practice of creating the great Homo Amor Library? Reach out to me for the holy opportunity. My email is in the chat box now. Today, I want to celebrate and give a very deep bow to Myra Bennett, who continually takes actions to support One Mountain Many Paths, like gifting her friends membership, working on our social media team. And Myra also builds community by thinking about how to share the Dharma with her community and by participating in our One Mountain Many Paths Saturday study groups. Myra, we honor how you are setting your life ever more deeply on course with the evolution of love. What to expect from today? First, a Dharma recap from myself from last week. Then Dr. Gafni will set our intention, and then David will resonate our evolutionary love code. And then we move into our evolutionary sermons with Dr. Marc Gafni, and sometimes with a clip from Barbara Marx Hubbard. And then we close. Then we move into meditation to enter prayer, actually. And then we close with Krista, who invites us deeper into community, and then we bring everyone on at the end for an intimate dance party and our goodbyes. Marc writes evolutionary love codes. Marc and Barbara study those codes together, often comparing them with Barbara's own 52 codes for conscious self-evolution. These codes crystallize the new story of humanity, quote, evolving the course of consciousness and culture, which is the source code of love, unquote. We have the privilege to be part of the emergence of these first principles and first values. So we often try to end at the top of the hour, and we often go over. So know that the Dharma gates are open, and every week we are blessed with the flow. I welcome all who are new here. We need you. Know that each week is a standalone, and every week builds on the weeks before. One mountain, many paths, is radically committed to telling the new intimate universe story. Now for my recap from last week. Making sense of the world through Ukraine. The new love story emerges, the new peace. There are human beings dying. We are at a very specific time, a time when the fate of the world is being decided. Will there be a future world? The world is interlocking. Everything's connected to everything else. The unbearable intimacy of a globally interconnected world, which has multiple vectors of capacity to self-destruct. That's the time we live in. We breathe that in and we don't look away. We turn towards the suffering and we act in every possible way. We need to be love in action. How do we create a world in which the impending dominoes of catastrophic and existential risks that could emerge from Ukraine are no longer possible? A key piece of the Dharma, the new world vision, what we call cosmo-erotic humanism, can be brought to bear on this question. As our evolutionary love code said last week, reality can only be healed by the evolution of love, or the evolution of intimacy, and requires powerful, sacred, and value-driven intimacy at the egocentric, ethnocentric, world-centric, and cosmocentric levels. Egocentric means we have shared identity in our egocentric world. Ethnocentric intimacy means we've got a larger sense of shared identity for me, my nation, my people. World-centric means we have an actual sense of shared identity and intimacy with every human being on the planet. Cosmocentric intimacy means I have shared identity, not just with every human being, not just with the planet, but with evolution itself, with every living animal, and with all living beings. The evolution of intimacy means the capacity to evolve from one level to the next level of intimacy. We need all four levels. We can't exclude any level. To be the new human and the new humanity, we embody all four. If you leave out one, we can't do real politic and we can't do ethos. Ethos is rooted in eros, and eros is the largest wholeness or the largest aliveness possible. We can't split off any dimension of aliveness or any dimension of wholeness, or there's no shalom, no peace. We can't have peace unless we can actually be whole. We have to be peace to contain within the depth of our being all levels of intimacy. there's an invitation at play here. The invitation is at this moment in time, we have to participate in the evolution of love. This is ours to do. We can't wait for someone else to do it. To be a lover at this moment is to say, I am willing to take responsibility for the whole. How many of us ever thought we would be in a conversation like this, where what we do today in our sense making is part of a fabric, a process that can actually evolve love? Reality can be healed by the evolution of love. Now I invite us to more deeply enter the holy and the sacred space of one mountain, many paths, and I turn my word to you, Dr. Marc Gafni.
Thank you so, so much, Tahalee, and what a gorgeous and important, right, and beautifully just through Kristina Amel on this, right, Dharma recapitulation, and every word mattered. And Kristina every week takes the actual direct words that we used the week before and weaves them together in a new order to capitulate, like we do in symphony, right? The essence of the evolution of love that we were reaching for, right, in the previous week. Who are we, right? Who are we here in One Mountain? We are not a church, and we are a church. We're not a synagogue, and we are a synagogue, and we're not a secular humanist center, and we are a secular humanist center. We are here convening to enact together a new world philosophy, a new understanding of what reality is that weaves together. We call that the new story, that weaves together the best validated insights of pre-modern, modern, and post-modern wisdom streams into a new story, a new whole, greater than the sum of its parts. And a new story is a new configuration of intimacy. It weaves together values, intrinsic values, in a new configuration and a new relationship, and creates out of the validated knowing we have, merged with the unknowing, the cloud of unknowing, the mystery. We're always in devotion to the mystery. So the mystery and the knowing which is sensual, which is real, which is carnal knowledge, as the interior sciences understand it, v'adam yada et chava ishto, and man knew his wife Eve, right? The knowing, the sense-making which is sensual, where we overcome our alienation from reality and we're able to stand in certainty. Amidst all the ambiguity, we disambiguate and we find our way and we find a North Star and we liberate ourselves from moral equivalencies, even as like the great Russian writers did. That was the greatness of Russian literature. Even as we hold the intense complexity of the moral, of the ethical. So we stand in first values and first principles. We decry and transcend moral equivalencies. We understand that there's a hierarchy of value, but that that hierarchy is a holistic hierarchy. It's not a dominator hierarchy. We understand that as we confront literally existential risk, as we're poised between utopia and dystopia, as we're willing not to turn away but to turn towards, we understand that to alleviate suffering, we have to tell a new story. And that all suffering in the world, all unnecessary suffering, right, stems from in virtually, not all, but virtually all suffering is unnecessary suffering, stems from a failure of eros, a failure of intimacy, which at its core is a failure of story. Zach Stein and I spent about 24 intense hours the last couple of days trying to delineate what are the 15 clear expressions of what I call the global intimacy disorder. right? We call it together here, the global intimacy disorder. And at the core of the global intimacy disorder is a failure of story. Because whether it's between a couple or between a nation or between nations, only a shared story generates intimacy. And a shared story has to be a shared story of value. But if you've deconstructed value, right, if we're in this postmodern moment which says that value is not real, and that modern postmodern moment suffuses Putin and suffuses in a different way, no moral equivalence, but in a different way, the World Economic Forum and the emergent, what we call techno-feudalism, right? The reduction of the human being to a commodity whose free will is undermined, whose data is extracted to be quantified through machine intelligence into predictive analysis, which is sold to misaligned third parties for the sake of power and profit. Wow. Right? And so we've got to stand against that. We can only stand against that if we're standing in a story, a shared story, which is a shared story of value, rooted in first values and first principles. And we cannot approach Ukraine, and we cannot approach Aleppo in Syria. Aleppo in Syria, which is happening right now. Aleppo in Syria, which is tragically happening right now. Right? We can't approach the Congo. We can't approach Yemen. Right? We can't approach Afghanistan. Right? How many people have forgotten that people who worked with the West deeply and profoundly were left behind in Afghanistan with no one to place the light of attention, right, on what's happening in Afghanistan right now in this second? Right? How many of us have thought about Afghanistan this week? Because all the energy, appropriately, was drawn into the tragedy of Ukraine because it's a Western white nation, right, part of Europe. And we stand with Ukraine. We've been talking about Ukraine intensely. We've been living with Ukraine. We're involved in every possible way, and we should be involved. We should be involved as a citizens' army. We should be disrupting all forms of communication that involve Russia's effort to destroy Ukraine. We should be sending messages. We should be responding to disinformation. We should be participating in boycotts. We should be taking in refugees. We should be funding. We should be doing all of it. Right? There should be a decentralized mass world movement to stop Putin, for sure. And right here in one mountain, that's insufficient. It's utterly necessary, but insufficient. Because actually, it's not going to take us home. It will do what it needs to do in every way, and we have to do it 1,000% right now in this second. Right? But in order to actually alleviate suffering, to actually in this moment poised between utopia and dystopia, to actually move towards a potential utopia, to actually stand against existential risk, which is not just Ukraine, but which is 14 or 15 different existential risks stacked together, which threaten all of the unborn, which threaten the future of humanity itself in a real way, right? We have to actually stand and actually tell a new story of value that becomes the context for our diversity. That's what we're here to do. Right? It's a Da Vinci moment. Not more than 1,000 people involved in the Renaissance, right? As Paul Tillich pointed out. The Black Death decimating Europe. Pain and suffering of unimaginable proportion all around. And Da Vinci and his cohorts understood that we need to take in refugees. We need to heal the Black Death. Right? Even though we don't have means to do it sometimes, we have to do everything we can. But at the very core, Da Vinci and his cohorts understood we need to tell a new story of value. And that was the beginning of modernity. And to the extent that modernity got it right, all the dignities of modernity were born, from universal human rights to feminism, the emergence of the feminine, right, to education, right, to social mobility, right, to the goods of technology that actually allow us to talk to each other in this very moment, right, to new forms of moral reasoning, the gorgeous dignities of modernity. But to the precise extent that modernity, from David Hume on, got the storyline wrong, to the precise extent that modernity deconstructed intrinsic value, And as Habermas has already written, postmodernity's deconstruction is just modernity on steroids, the major threat of modernity on steroids. To the precise extent that modernity avoided articulating a genuine new language of intrinsic value, that modernity lost, appropriately so, in its rebellion against the pre-modern traditions and their shadows, didn't actually engage in a reconstructive project. Right? It talked about the values of modernity, but even those weren't intrinsic values. Even those, modernity wasn't willing to stand against David Hume and against key strains in Kant and against Wittgenstein and logical positivism, as beautiful as Ludwig was, right? And actually claim a new vision of value as a context for our diversity and a new vision of evolving value, of intrinsic value. A value which actually is a quality of cosmos itself that lives in us, as us, and through us, and value that we can access because the mysteries are within us. Anthro-ontology, anthro, right? Within our very humanity ontology, the mysteries live. And goodness, truth, and beauty live in us. And in order to respond to Ukraine, we have to tell a new story of value in the deepest, most potent, most powerful way we can on every level. Wow. So I want to thank everyone for being here. Like, welcome everyone. I want to thank everyone in this unique self symphony, right, for stepping up. I want to thank Elena. I know you're doing such a huge job this week. I can't wait to read the text with Paul for the incredible work on transcribing. I want to invite and editing and reformulating and the artistic editing, right, that's being done. I want to invite anyone who wants to step in, and whether it's to working with Krista, or working with Kristina and the Great Library team, or working on the festival this summer with Claire and Shahat, or whatever the project is, or with Jamie, right, and Jacqueline, right, working with Barry, whoever, but if you want to step in and be part of this unique self-symphony that's telling this story, right, step in to resource, right, to fund, step in to fund with your heart and with your time, with your writing, with your skill, right, with your editing. Let's do this together. Right, we've got to become a voice, right, for the new story. And we articulate every week some piece of the new story, and we spend the last 3 weeks deep in Ukraine, and we're still there. So what I want to do this week with permission is, I want to, you know, begin. We're going to do two parts today. We're going to do two parts. Welcome everyone, and it's so good to be here. Are we ready? Have we set our intention? I want to find each other in the chat box. Have we set our intention? Is our intention clear? Is our intention clear? Are we ready? Are you ready? Are we ready? Are we ready to play a larger game? Are we ready to play a larger game? Are we ready to participate, right, in the evolution of love together? Are we ready to play a larger game? Are we ready to participate in the evolution of love? Oh my God. Oh my God. Here we go. Here we go. So David, we're going to do two parts today. We're going to do a code. We're going to step into Ukraine more deeply. And this week, we're not going to step into Ukraine from the perspective of new Dharma. We're going to just, I just want to feel. We're just going to try and open our hearts and feel and comment, right, and speak into that feeling. And then we're going to do part two, which is how we respond to Ukraine in one particular dimension of a response that I want to talk about today. Okay, which is hugely important. So David, give us our evolutionary love code this week. Brother, take us inside.
Thank you, Mark. Welcome, everyone. So this is where we resonate the code, which is a distillation of what we're focusing on for this week. And, you know, something I was reflecting on is how much being in this community, it's allowed me to open my heart, right, to world-centric intimacy, to cosmos-centric intimacy, and to feel the outrageous pain and the outrageous love at a larger scale, and actually be able to sit with that in a way that in other communities I haven't been able to find as much. And so here we are, we're holding this, and sometimes it's overwhelming. Sometimes I get paralyzed. And yet here we are being called to lean in to value, to lean into our unique risk and participate in the evolution of love. So with that, it's a pleasure to resonate the code, which is, it's beautiful. And I'll resonate it a couple times here. What does God need from me at all times, and especially right now? God needs me to pray. God needs me to partner. God needs me to be God. God needs me to be human. God needs me to be an atheist. God needs me to trust. God needs me to cry. And God needs me to laugh. What does God need from me at all times, and especially right now? Fill into this. What does God need from me? God needs me to pray, to be a partner. God needs me to be God and to be human. God needs me to be an atheist. God needs me to trust and to cry and to laugh. And with that, I turn my word back to you, beloved Dr. Marc.
Let's look at that code together and feel that code. And that's going to guide us, right, for this week and for next week. And next week, what we're going to do is we're going to also have an open question and answer. I know there's been a lot of questions in the last 3 weeks, and we've been laying down, as it were, the deepest tracks of what is the emergent new understanding that comes from this moment, and how do we do sense making, right, in the deepest way possible. A number of my friends wrote, and I madly appreciated it, right, is that this is the best sense making the last 3 weeks they've heard, and they've read, you know, hundreds of articles. So we did the best sense making, not because we're smart, right, but because we're just laying our lives down for it. We've got to be able to do sense making here, to become intimate with what's happening, right, to respond to this Ukraine, but to respond to all the potential future Ukraines, which were part of a larger landscape of existential risk. But the next 2 weeks, we're going to engage in a different dimension of sense making. So next week, I'm going to invite questions and answers. We're going to do a piece of Dharma, of teaching, of sharing, right, of practice next week. But we're also going to have time for open mic questions and answers. So I want to invite everyone to, if you have a particular question, to write it. Let us know in advance. There'll also be place for live questions. So we're going to really have a kind of community gathering of voices next week, and particularly, you know, a deep question and answer conversation. Okay, so everyone got that for next week? Okay. And the code for this week, we're going to look at the code for this week and for next week. David, thank you for your beautiful reading, and we can always hear your heart, and your heart opens our heart. What does God need from me at all times, and especially right now? God needs me to pray. So we're going to talk about prayer maybe this week. Maybe we'll spend a big part of next week on prayer. But prayer is hugely important. We'll talk about prayer. Right, God needs me to partner. God needs me to be God. God needs me to be human. God needs me to be an atheist. God needs me to trust. God needs me to cry. Not God needs me to laugh, right? All of those. We have to do all of those literally at the same time, okay? And we're going to talk about a bunch of them this week, but let's just begin just by opening our hearts and feeling. And Claire, you send in, right, a clip, right, which I just saw. So let's start there, just to sit back, right, and open our hearts. And we've never been at this kind of moment in history before. A generation ago, only God could see the degree of suffering that any human being that's willing to plug in and not turn away can see today. And the level of images of suffering that are available, right, to every human being were only available to God or to those people proximate right there in the moment. And in many ways, that causes us to turn away. I talked to some dear people last week that I'm studying with, and I said, have you tracked Ukraine? Fantastic people, deep, you know, leaders in what I would call kind of conscious communities. And they said, no, we're not following Ukraine. And it's very easy to turn away. And the reason we turn away is not because we're evil. And this is deep, my friends. We turn away because we don't know what to do. We don't turn away because we're, as Enlightenment teachers would like us to believe, because we're trapped in our narcissism. We turn away because we feel so much. And when there's a gap between our ability to feel the pain and our ability to heal the pain, we turn away, right? So we have to be able to close that gap, and that's what we're going to talk about today. We have to be able to close that gap. Again, we turn away in the gap between our ability to feel the pain and our ability to heal the pain. We have to close that gap. We're going to talk about how we do that today. But for now, let's open our hearts to feel. So take us inside. Right? We live in a world of outrageous pain. The only response to outrageous pain is outrageous love. Not theodicy, not explaining why the suffering's happening, but to actually respond in outrageous love. The only response to outrageous pain is outrageous love. And outrageous love is not a quality which human beings created. It's the quality of cosmos itself. We live in a cosmo-erotic universe, in an amorous cosmos. From the very inception of the Big Bang in its singularities. The allurement and autonomy and the dance between allurement and autonomy that drives cosmos at every level. From the three quarks that come together in a holy trinity, gazillions of them in 16 particular configurations of intimacy, quarks, forms of quarks, raining through reality in the first nanoseconds of the Big Bang to 380,000 years later when protons, electrons, and neutrons dance in allurement to create a larger whole, a new configuration of intimacy called an atom. And when atoms come together, literally, not then, but now, in your body, exponential trillions of atoms literally in your body, in my body right now, in this second, dancing in configurations of allurement and unique allurement. Unique allurement, which is you, because you are literally, you are a unique set of allurements. Reality is a love story. And the reason we're outraged is because reality is a love story, because it's not supposed to be this way. And the pictures you saw are both about outrageous pain, but they're also outrageous love. Those pictures were lined with outrageous love, with people helping each other, people loving each other, with life moving to life. Life moving to life. We live in a world of outrageous beauty. We live in a world of outrageous goodness. We live in a world of outrageous truth, and beauty holds in it truth and goodness. Beauty is the ultimate eros of cosmos. And beauty is the ability to include everything. Everyone's included on the inside. Great Russian literature is included on the inside. And all of the Russians who are horrified at the war are included on the inside. And the tragedy, the utter tragedy of Russian troops thinking they were going on a training exercise and writing home one soldier to his mother, right before he was killed. Mama, but I don't know what's happening here. Right? Yes, we have to fight and defeat Putin, but there's no one outside the circle. I remember an old Russian song. Pust svegda bude sunset, pust svegda bude nebo. Пусть всегда будет мама, пусть всегда будет я. May there always be sunshine. May there always be sunset. May there always be mama. May there always be you. In precise translation, I just made it up as I went. Небо is actually blue sky. Let's try it again. May there always be sunset. May there always be blue skies. May there always be mama. May there always be you. No one's excluded, right? Every Russian soldier, right, who doesn't understand what he's doing in a tank and who's hit by a missile, right, that the United States just sent to the Ukraine appropriately. So that's the tragedy of war, that blows up, right, a Russian tank with five guys inside with girlfriends at home and mothers who have no idea what's happening. And no one's outside the circle. What beauty means, right, and in the interior sciences, beauty is tiferet. It's that which includes all opposites. In the tree of life, beauty is that which includes all opposites. And Whitehead had a sense of this. Beauty includes all of goodness and all of truth. No one's outside the circle, right? We have to stand with Ukraine. Glory to Ukraine and glory to the heroes in this moment. And no one's outside the circle. There's a bigger vision. Okay. Wow. We live in a world of outrageous pain. The only response to outrageous pain is outrageous love. And outrageous love means that there is an eros of cosmos. Eros is the eros, the quality of outrageous love that we just described a couple of minutes ago, moving from quarks through subatomic particles, through atoms, through molecules, through macromolecules, through cells, prokaryotes to eukaryotes, all the way up the evolutionary chain and into the entire biosphere, the entire noosphere. Noosphere, where's that word noosphere? It came from Vladimir, who was a cosmist, who was a Russian theorist, right? In the early 1920s, he talked about the noosphere, right? The world of mind and culture and consciousness. All of it is animated by eros. All of it's driven by outrageous love, by evolutionary love. So that evolutionary love, right, lives in us. It's who we are. Who are we? We're unique configurations of outrageous love. And every Russian soldier, and every Ukrainian soldier who should be fighting the Russian soldier in this tragic moment is a unique configuration of intimacy, not a social construction of social, psychological, and cultural conditioning. That's a statistic, right, in the annals of the dogs of war, but an irreducible, unique expression of the love intelligence and love beauty that got tragically snuffed out in that moment, right? And so who are we? Who are we right here? What? We're not living in Russia or the Ukraine. My family lived very close to the Ukraine. I come from generations, right, of Polish people. Both my parents are Poles, right? Both of them spend time in the Ukraine. Both of them, right, lost family members to Ukrainians who participated with the Nazis. It's a complex world. And Ukraine's moved to transform itself, and a nation gets to transform itself, and it is in full and mad and gorgeous glory. We've got to create a future together, right? We live in a world of outrageous pain. The only response is outrageous love. And who are you? Who am I? Who are we? Right? You are an outrageous lover. That's who you are. And so we just saw this clip and we feel the pain. But we close our hearts, right? We close our hearts. We don't, because there's a gap between our ability to feel the pain and our ability to heal the pain. So how do we close that gap? We close that gap by knowing that it's not ours to heal the whole thing. Right? No one of us can heal it all together. But each one of us is an outrageous lover. An outrageous lover has outrageous acts of love to commit. That's what it means to be an outrageous lover. An outrageous lover means there are unique, outrageous acts of love to commit that are mine and mine alone to commit. And we come together individually as unique selves playing our instrument, but here in One Mountain, we come together as a unique self symphony, playing together our unique instrument, committing our outrageous acts of love to love open reality and evolve the source code itself. And at this moment in time, there's two sets of things to do. One is anything we can do directly in regards to Ukraine, because Putin has to lose. That's critical. And there's no moral equivalence. And we've talked about the complexity last 3 weeks, but right now let's just stand and there's no moral equivalence. And at the same time, we need to actually be involved in deeper work which is the Da Vinci work. In this time between worlds and time between stories, we have to together as a unique self-symphony. It's not going to come from Harvard Divinity School, which is lost in postmodern deconstruction. It's not going to come from the Sorbonne. There's a reason why I left Oxford and Zach left Harvard and lots of us left other places here where we could have participated. We came here together because this is the place where we want to be in the throbbing heart of evolution itself. We want to participate in evolving the source code. And we're going to enact a great library. A great library, right? Of Darwin level, Freud level, not in content, but in terms of level of seriousness, writings that can actually reweave the source code. Not fundamentalist declarations, not New Age declarations, not human potential movement, right? Another form of therapy. Those all have their place. But at this moment in time, it's only telling the new story that can close the gap, right? So what's ours to do? Whatever you can do directly in Aleppo and Ukraine and Yemen, in your own community, and to come together and participate directly in evolving the source code. And that's huge. It's huge. Now here's the next step. What has Ukraine reminded us? And I want to do something very, very difficult here and tender and quivering, right, and fierce. This is going to be the next step. So to take us into the next step, I want to look at a clip. And this is a clip which is the clip of a poem. And it's a poem by an incredible Ukrainian poet who writes both in the Russian and the Ukrainian languages. The poem was written in response to Russia's occupation of Crimea in 2014. The poem celebrates the Ukrainian revolution for democracy, for the values of freedom, right? For the values of human rights, for the rejection of the authoritarian state, for the dignity of the individual, the dignity of human choice. And the poem, written by Anastasia Dmitruk, and Anastasia Dmitruk appears at the beginning of the clip we're about to see. And the poem reads, "We will never be brothers," right? And this is the rejection of Mother Russia, meaning ethnocentric intimacy for its own sake. Ethnocentric intimacy as a fig leaf covering up raw, naked power drives, which appeals, right, to the most base drives of untransformed humanity. Humanity with her wounds untransformed, that covers up the gaping hole of emptiness by the pseudo eros of the raw drive for power over in and of itself to give myself the feeling of being alive, right? Ethnocentric intimacy that doesn't stand for value. Ethnocentric intimacy, as we said, is beautiful, but every ethnocentric intimacy has to stand for a new vision of value. Russia, oh my God, I spend a decent part of this week late at night reading Russian literature again. And I'll talk maybe next week about the 10 major Russian literary figures, or to talk about their home being in Russian literature, which is the ability to speak with naked, honest, raw truth and authenticity about the deep eros and ethos of cosmos, right? So that's what Russia should stand for. But ethnocentric intimacy, which is Mother Russia, which is the rape of Mother Russia, using her as a fig leaf, right? That we have to reject. And that's what this poetess does, and she writes in her poem, "We will never be brothers, neither by fatherland nor by mother. You do not have the spirit to be free. You and us cannot even be allies. You've proclaimed yourself to be senior. We may be younger, but we are not yours. You are so many, but what a pity. You are all faceless. You are big, but we are grand. You keep pushing us. You keep drudging. You will choke on your own envy. Will, that word is unknown to you. Ever since your childhood, you've been in chains. At your place," meaning in Russia, silence, right, is gold. "Well, at ours, Molotov cocktails are burning. Yes, the blood in our hearts is hot. What are you to us, blind kinsfolk? Our eyes are fearless. Unarmed, we are still dangerous. We have matured and become bold at the gunpoint of a sniper. Executioners knocked us down on our knees. We've risen up and gotten even. The rats are not running to hide for nothing. They will bathe in their own blood. You keep getting new orders. We have flames of revolution that are burning here. You have the czar. We have democracy. We will never be brothers. Now, friends, in the end, we have to be brothers. And we have to share a brotherhood of value. And the tragedy of war is that when Nazis seek to overtake reality in World War II, the Allied forces had to confront the Nazis on D-Day and on the beaches of Normandy, right, and all across Europe. And today, although Putin is not a Nazi, right, he's not seeking the final solution of Ukraine. Putin is not Hitler. Putin is a different form of imperialist, but he's abandoned first values and first principles, and he is driving for power. He's not unleashing the full force of Russia on Ukraine. That's not actually accurate. Right? Actually, more weapons were fired, right, by the United States in Iraq, which was also in many ways, a necessary possible war, but a tragic war, but more sorties were flown by planes in Iraq on the first day than all the Russian sorties that have been flown since the beginning of this war. So Putin is operating from a place of evil, but he's not Hitler. Evil is taking place all over the place. There needs to be complete opposition to Putin. And we need to articulate a vision of value that binds reality, that becomes a context for our diversity. And Putin hasn't heard it yet. And nor has Xi, right, in China, right? They're all lost in a kind of postmodern deconstruction that's covered up in China by fig leaves of Confucianism and covered up in Russia by imperialist dreams of Mother Russia. But there's no genuine articulation of value. And when Putin looks at the West, he sees the shadows of egocentric intimacy, right? The failure to articulate any kind of vision of value, the failure to create a willingness to step up for other, to care for other, right? To feel, right, the world, to feel the country. He sees consumerism, right? He sees lowest common denominator, technocracy. But he's missing something, right? He actually misses underneath the beating heartthrob of democracy. And even if that heartthrob has faltered, which it has, Putin has actually paradoxically given us a gift. He's revived it. He's revived that commitment to value. And I want to add, and this is the big sentence that I was driving for, the realization that there's something worth dying for. And I want to understand that. If there's nothing that's worth dying for, then I'm not alive. And that's a major proposition. We talk about it in the Dharma, right, very, very deeply. Right, when we talk about pleasure, and we talk about levels of pleasure, and we'll come back to it after this clip, but there's a certain level of pleasure where I have the pleasure. And by pleasure, I don't mean simple surface pleasure, I mean deep pleasure. The pleasure of being willing to give up my life for a larger field of value. It's one of the greatest pleasures a human being has. Because if there's nothing I'm willing to die for, then I'm not alive. Then I've already died. Now, when I'm willing to die for a value, I also have a direct realization in my body that it's not over when it's over. That when I die into a larger field of value. I die into a larger field of consciousness. Just like in sexing, as John Donne, the English poet, writes, "Come, my darling, that I may die with you. Orgasm is a little death." Right? I die into a larger field of goodness, truth, and beauty. The hero reminds us that there's a larger field of value. And we have to all be heroes. We have to understand, what are we willing to die for? And if I have nothing I'm willing to die for, I'm not alive. We're willing to die for articulating the new Dharma. We're willing to die for telling the new story. And to die for it means that we're willing to make our lives inconvenient. We're willing to be uncomfortable. We're willing to do things that don't quite feel like what we should be doing. We're willing to move out of our egocentric narcissism, which might disguise itself sometimes as spirituality. We're willing to step up and give what the world needs. And for us here in One Mountain, that means we're going to do everything we can. We're going to resource in every way, on every level possible, the telling of this new story. There's something we're willing to die for. There's something we're willing to give up a little of our trust fund for, right? If there's nothing I'm willing to die for, I'm already dead, right? Because in the end, right, the one race that no one wins is the race with mortality in this lifetime. We all die in this lifetime. Death is part of the structure of life. Now, when I'm a hero, I realize I'm dying into something larger than myself. And then for the first time, I'm alive. So I want to play for you a song of heroes. And then we're going to come back and we're going to talk about who are we? What do we live for? And what are we willing to die for? But first, and I'm going to ask with just so gently, so much devotion to everyone here. Let's watch carefully and listen carefully. And we're going to see a clip now, which is a group of Ukrainians singing, playing, right, this song. The song of We Are Not Brothers. And again, we need to move beyond the song. And the song is filled, right, with an ethnocentric Ukrainian pride. But the ethnocentric Ukrainian pride is not Russian ethnocentrism. It's at its beating heart. It's a standing for democracy. It's a standing for human rights. It's a standing for value. And for value, I'm willing to give up my life. And that's when my life becomes valuable. So take us inside. Oh my God, here we go. And this is our meditation, my friends. And this is our prayer.
Никогда мы не будем братьями. Ни по родине, ни по матери. Духа нет у вас быть свободными. Нам не стать с вами даже сводными. Вы себя окрестили старшими, нам бы младшими, да не вашими. Вас так много, а жаль безликие. Вы огромные, мы великие.
Никогда мы не будем братьями ни по родине, ни по матери. Духа нет у вас быть свободными, нам не стать с вами даже сводными. Вы себя крестили старшими, нам вы младшими. Не вашими, вас так много, жаль, безликие, вы огромные.
Своей умоются. Ваш дух словия
Wow. Wow. Can you feel that? Right? Who can feel that? Find me in the chat box. Who can feel that? Right? Who can feel that? Right? Right? That is the song of the hero. That is the song of the hero. And the hero is willing to die for something. And I want to hold this really deeply and clearly. Because we've literally lost our relationship to life. Right? Can you feel that? Oh my God. Right? There are six levels of pleasure. I'm not going to go through all six. But at the very core of reality is a kind of quantum hedonism. Quantum hedonism means that pleasure, eros, drives reality all the way up and all the way down. From the allurement between three quarks that we talked about earlier, what one scientist called actually quantum hedonism, the hedon, at the pleasure that drives reality all the way through what Vladimir, the Russian cosmonaut, called the noosphere, right? This world of culture, this world of interiors that lives with inside the human being, inside the depth of the self-reflective human mind. So at the human level, okay, stay close, friends, right? So crazy beautiful. At the human level, I want to just talk for 1 minute about three levels of pleasure. And each level has its own price of entry. It has its own practice. There's no rate of exchange. I'm going to just spend a minute on it because I'm going to get to the third level. And David works together with Kristina and Suzette. And David's now, right, taking it on. Right, we're putting out a major book on this vision of pleasure. Pleasure is the source of all ethics. Pleasure is the source of all ethics. But we need to be able to discern levels of pleasure and to know what pleasure is, right? So the first level of pleasure, right, is the five senses. And there are shadow versions of that pleasure, of all of the five senses, and there are light or conscious or alive or whole versions of that pleasure. Right? All of the five senses. And to actually get the pleasure, you have to place attention. The price of the first level of pleasure is attention. Every level of pleasure has a counterfeit. The counterfeit of the first level of pleasure is novelty, right? Instead of actually knowing how to get pleasure, right, from physicality and it being new for the first time every time, we need something new every time because it's a counterfeit level of that pleasure. All of level one can't buy you any of level two. What's level two? What's level two pleasure? Level two pleasure is not the physical five senses, right? It is love, affection, and relationships. So all of level one can't buy you any of level two. Money can buy you marriage, but as the Beatles reminded us, money can't buy you love, right? That's level two pleasure. And so I'm willing to give up, right? Almost all of level one pleasure to get almost any of level two pleasure, right? Which is the depth of love, affection, relationships, and the practice, right? The practice is you actually have to learn the laws of loving, right? What are the principles of intimacy, right? What are the laws of love? How does love work? And the more effort and the more discernment and the more I open my heart and I cultivate, right, the practices of the heart, the more I love. That's level two pleasure. And of course, it has a shadow form as well. It has a counterfeit. The counterfeit of level two pleasure might be infatuation. Right? Or level two pleasure might be, right, a false love. So Putin's love of Mother Russia, right? Or the tragic elements in Ukrainian societies, right? Fascistic love of the Ukraine, not the democratic Ukraine, right? Those are tragic expressions of ethnocentric love, right? So there can be false loves. There can be love stories that are tragic. There are bad love stories, and not every love story, right, is a holy love story. There's distorted love stories. Okay, so that could be the shadow. whether it's infatuation on a personal level or infatuation on a natural, on a national level. But all of level two can't get you any of level three. And I'm not going to do four, five, and six today. I want to get to three. What's level three? Right, level three is an entirely new level of pleasure. So all of the pleasure of level two doesn't get you any of the pleasure of level three. What's the pleasure of level three, friends? The pleasure of level three was in that clip we just saw. What's the pleasure of level three? Right? What's the pleasure of level three? What's the pleasure of level three? What did you see in that clip, friends, beloveds? What did you see in that clip? That was pleasure in that clip. Who's going to tell me there was no pleasure in that clip? Tell me. Anybody tell me there was no pleasure in that clip? You're lying. Was there pleasure in that clip? But was there pleasure? I want you to feel the pleasure in it. Find the pleasure underneath the sacrifice, underneath the cause of the endangered species, right? Underneath the commitment. Yes, Dawn, you're right. Elena, of course you're right. Benjamin, yes, right? Yeah, language, yes. But there was pleasure, right? There was the pleasure of standing for a cause, right? Right, right, right. In other words, patriotism, right? Sacrifice, commitment, right? In standing for a just cause is an enormous pleasure. We've identified pleasure with superficial pleasure that runs against ethics, but that's not what pleasure is. Pleasure is the deep feeling of alignment, right? And an enormous sense of being whole and right in a profound way. Do you think that those people singing experienced pleasure? I experienced pleasure listening to them. But pleasure's not surface, right? Pleasure's very deep, right? That's the pleasure of standing for a just cause. And it's the pleasure even of being willing to give my life for a higher field of value. And that, strangely enough, in the strange unfolding of the evolution of consciousness, is what Putin reminded the West was true. That actually, West, you guys stand for something. He didn't mean to remind the West that that was true. He actually read the West as being egocentric, and he read the West as being the shadow versions of level one and level two pleasure. But actually, deep within the soul of the democratic world, and actually of the entire world, right, is this yearning for freedom, this yearning for participation in governance, this yearning for universal human rights, this yearning for fair process, right, this yearning for individuation, this yearning, right, for all the possibilities, the great goods and dignities, right, of modernity, at the best of the Western Enlightenment, the best values of the Western Enlightenment. And those best values of the Western Enlightenment are values that the Ukrainians are reminding the world are worth dying for, right? According to at least six or seven major studies, right? If you want to see one place where they're cited, I mentioned it last week by Zuboff in the last chapter of her book, Surveillance Capitalism, but there's numerous other places, right, have shown that the actual belief in the value of democracy, right, the understanding that democracy is a value, right, has gone way down among millennials, right, in the West. We forgot that democracy itself is part of the ongoing process of divine revelation. Revelation is an ongoing evolutionary process. Hegel got it right. And Hegel reflects Luria, right, the great teaching of Luria, which speaks about the evolving spirit. And the evolving spirit is the evolution of value itself. And democracy is an expression of the divine unfolding spirit incarnate in the body politic. And if we just take it for granted, we take the way we do information gathering the right way for granted, right? We take fundamental human rights, we take innocent until proven guilty for granted. And we've done that all over the Western world. Right? Wow. We begin to lose touch with that vibrating, pulsing, throbbing expression of revelation, which is the democratic world, which is a critical stage in the evolution of love and the evolution of consciousness. And literally, we see it all over the world disappearing. We see it in woke culture disappearing, where people write when, you know, someone's accused of something, right? Instead of gathering evidence and doing information gathering, right, there's a new term by the press in the last 10 years, right? It says this person's credibly accused, That's a term created by the press to bypass the process of information gathering and fact-checking, which is the very core of democracy. The very, very core of democracy is how we gather information. Who we are is how we gather information. Standing against Putin is standing for, right, proper discernment and sense-making, right, in gathering information about people, right, and how we share that information. And actually, the World Wide Web has become a collapse of sense-making, right, a collapse, right, of the processes of justice, right, a defacing, right, of Lady Justice, and we've forgotten that it's true. But until Putin reminds us, and Ukrainians standing against Putin remind us, no, these are values, and that we're not brothers with tyranny, right, and fascism, right? We're brothers, right, in a brotherhood of value. Wow, right? Does everyone understand this? Like, wow, right, is democracy flawed? Yes, it's flawed, right? Is democracy a dream in the making? Yes, it is, right? But we can't defer the dream. Langston Hughes, the black poet, writes, what happens to a dream deferred? It dries up like a raisin in the sun. We've got to fulfill the dream. But we got to fulfill the dream standing for the values of democracy. And paradoxically, in the West itself, the values of democracy, right, are being effaced in a thousand different ways. We've got to stand. Freedom is a critical value. We take it for granted. It disappears. And authoritarianism of the Putin version, and again, with no moral equivalence, but of the vision that's envisioned by technocracy, right, unfolding, right, and the web and the algorithm being the authority to which there's no appeal, right, free will being undermined, right, by the manipulations, right, of algorithms, right, which are exponentially adjusted to finely tune and personally target every single human being to affect their decision making. Wow. Okay, so wow, so let's just feel this together. And that song was gorgeous, and it was pleasurable. So I want to ask you a question, friends, and this is a hard question. Right, what are you willing to die for? Now, that's a big deal. And I'm not asking anyone to die for something. I'm saying know what you're willing to die for, and then live for it. Right? In Oriana, I was about to use an expletive deleted word to amplify the word live, but I promised you I won't because we're in one mountain. So that's for you, Oriana. I got you. I remember our conversation. I'm in with you, sister. Okay? But oh my God, freaking live for it, right? So what are we willing to stand for, right? The world needs a new source code. The world needs a new vision of value. The world needs the telling of the new story. My dear beloved evolutionary partner, Barbara Marx Hubbard, right, laid down her life to tell the new story, independently of Barbara, right? I was laying down my life to tell the new story, and we found each other and we said, oh my God, right? We're actually vibrating at the same frequency, and we spend 5 years, right, in deep, deep shared evolutionary vision, right? Right, in this vibrational place of, and from that place, we started one mountain, and you started one mountain with us, and we're partners in one mountain, and it's our job here to do what Harvard and Oxford and the Sorbonne, right, are not gonna do, and Heidelberg's not gonna do. We have to actually put all of our energy and be willing to die for the telling of the new story. Now, here's the good news. Here's the good news, beloveds. Here's the good news. When you die, it's not over. We've talked about that in other contexts, but death, right, is a night between 2 days. Right, death is a night between 2 days. We have an enormous amount of real information about the continuity of consciousness. We have real information that's available in three different ways, philosophically, and careful readings of materialism and dualism. We have it available through actually gathering information about remote viewing, about all the realms of parallel psychology, about reincarnation, the work of Ian Stevens. But we also have, right, the knowing in our bodies. We have direct access, right, to the experience of the hero and to at least 7 or 8 other anthropological experiences that tell us that there's continuity of consciousness. So when I'm willing to die for something, I'm not dying into the blackness and into the void. I'm dying into the higher field of value. But it requires sacrifice. It requires focusing on the higher field of value and saying, wow, that higher field of value calls me. I'm willing to die for it. And now that I'm willing to die for it, don't die for it. Oh my God, live for it. Right? That's the invitation. So I want to step into the chat box, friends. Okay, I want to step into the chat box. Right? What are you willing to die for? right? What are you willing to die for? Right? Anyone, I want to invite people in the chat box, right? Just right. Say, what am I willing to do in one mountain, right? To make this vision real, it's I'm willing to die for it. What value, right? What gift, right? What am I willing to die for? Anybody, anybody for the new world, Pavle, right? I'm willing to die for the new world. Okay, anybody else? For wholeness is the game. Cullen, right? I'm willing to die to create wholeness. Right, Jacqueline, I'm willing to die for the evolution of love. Right, Terry, I'm willing to die for love. Right, David, I'm willing to die for unique self-emergence shared with all separate selves. Krista, Joseph, I'm willing to die for a global communion of outrageous lovers. Right, right. Jamie Long, I'm willing to die for my beloveds. But Jamie, tell us who your beloveds are. Right, it's the woman you live with who's gorgeous, but it's more, it's a bigger circle of beloveds. So we hear you. Elena, right, there are two kinds of Russia, right? Right, so give us what you're willing to die for. Right, give us what you're willing to die for. What are we willing to die for? For democracy, says Enika. Right, for the equality of humanity, right? For the equality of humanity, right? To challenge Elena, to challenge, I'm willing to die to challenge this empire, right? And to create, right? A communion of love. I'm willing to die, Ujus, for truth, consciousness, and love. I'm willing to die into the field of lovers, right? Elena says, not for Russia. I got you, Elena. What's the yes, right? Unless I'm willing to die for something, I'm not alive. And to be willing to die for something doesn't mean to go die for it, it means to live for it. But I'm willing to die for art that's gorgeous. Right, Tolstoy's What is Art? One of the greatest pieces of writing ever written, right? For art, that makes me cry. That makes me cry, right? And that's how great Russian writers understood Russian literature, right? Right? In other words, there's key poets who would write a poem and their friends would tell them at the time of Stalin, their friends would tell them, right, it's a suicide note. And the poets would say, no, but this is art and art has to tell the truth. Art is goodness, truth, and beauty. I'm willing to die for art, right? Oriana, I'm willing to die to be alive as the one heart, right? I'm willing to die for a world, says Kirsten Zohar, based on outrageous love, right? I'm willing to die for the goodness of Russia, right? For peace and beauty, says Luis. Marilyn, right? Right, now just listen to this, right? Right, Marilyn says, it sounds like the cry of Islamic terrorists. No, but here's the point. This is the point, Marilyn, that's exactly where we get confused. Islamic terrorists are the shadow of level three pleasure. Does everyone get it? I want everyone to get this. That's correct. It was Osip Mandelstam. That was Osip who writes, his wife writes about it. That's exactly right. His wife writes that he knew he was writing a suicide note by writing that poem. And he says to his wife, he says, you know, Russia's the only place where we take poets seriously because we killed them for their poems. Thank you, Elena. That's exactly, it was precisely Osip. But I want to go back to Marilyn's comment. Right, but she says, Marilyn says beautifully, she says, right, don't we sound like the cry of Islamic terrorists? So stay close. The shadow, we said every level of pleasure has its counterfeit, its shadow. So the counterfeit of level three pleasure is to die for a false cause. Does everyone get that? Right, Marilyn, you're exactly right. The counterfeit of level three pleasure is to die for a false cause. But let me ask you a question, right? Were the boys from Montana, were beloved Lori Galperin's father on the beach of Normandy, right? Were they willing to die for a false cause? Right, if you wanna see just one scene, right? Look at the opening scene to Tom Hanks's movie, Saving Private Ryan, where, you know, he just depicts it, right, in art, right? People willing to die for a true cause. See, we've identified dying for a cause as Islamic terrorists. We've identified dying for a cause as dying for a false cause. No, we're willing to die for a true cause. Because here's the story, friends. We're all going to die. And we should do everything we can to choose life. We do everything we can to save every human life. We do everything we can to live the fullest, longest, most beautiful, good, and true life that we can. But if life becomes an idolatry, right, meaning the entire goal of life is to live as long and as comfortably as I can, then that idol is going to be shattered on the day of my death. I have to know that there's continuity of consciousness. I have to know that there's a larger field of life. I have to know that we're all heroes. And the hero knows that it's worth giving up my life for the larger field. And then the job of the hero is not then. Sometimes we're called to give up our life, right? Sometimes we're called to give up our life. That's true. Yet my grandfather gave up his life, right, as a partisan, right, in Poland, right? My sons have been, thank God, safe, and may they be safe till 120. They've been willing to risk their lives in battle, right, commanding their troops more than once. And that I've seen students of mine, 18 and 19, give up their lives protecting democracy, right, in the Middle East. I mean, I've buried more students, right, who are 18 or 19 than you'd like to know. Right, it's a big deal. So what does it mean to live simply protecting my comfort zone and not having anything to die for? And again, let me say it again. It's not about dying for it, it's about living for it, right? If I'm willing to die for art, live for art, right? If I'm willing to die, Sherry, you say beautifully, for nowness and wholeness and allness and oneness, then live for it. If I'm willing to die for freedom, right, live for freedom, right? Oh my God. And if I'm willing to die for democracy, live for democracy, right? And what would it mean, right, to live in a world where we actually knew that death was actually, right? Death was actually, right, the invitation to the larger field. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. It's not about killing someone else, right? It's about being willing in your heart and body to give up your life for a larger value. And I want to tell you something kind of gorgeous and beautiful, and it's so deep. It's so deep, friends. Shneur Zalman of Ladi, one of the great, great masters, lives, you know, at the time or a little before Kierkegaard, right? He says that the intention of the human being in every day is Mesirut Nefesh. I go inside and I find the intention, which is I find what I'm willing to die for. And that every day, let's stay close, every day, I identify when I wake up in the morning, what is the value that I'm willing to die for, right? And that's literally my practice in the morning. And so Krista Joseph in our practice, let's put this down as a practice. Kirsten Zohar, Tom, right? Practice, that's the practice. The practice is to identify, but very specifically, not generally, right? Not generally, right? Right, very specifically, what am I willing to die for? What's the vision I'm willing to die for? And then to identify, how am I today gonna live for those values I'm willing to die for? So if I'm willing to die for the new story of value, which is the evolution of love, what am I doing today? What's my commitment? What am I willing to sacrifice for? It's a big deal. It's a big deal. Putin thought, right, that the forces of democracy and the forces of freedom, right, actually had lost their capacity to live into those values and therefore to be willing to die for them. And Ukraine has reminded the world that we're all heroes and all of us are in Ukraine's debt. But it's not enough for Ukrainians to be heroes, right? Every human being has to be a hero. And here in One Mountain, we have to be heroes. And to be heroes, right, right, we are madly grateful that to be heroes in our lives, right, as they stand right now in this moment, it doesn't mean to physically die, but it means to actually go through the interior process that Shneur Zalman of Ladi, the great Hasidic master, right, in the early 19th century said was the most essential human practice. He called it, I'll write it in the chat box, he called it M-E-S-I-R-U-T, Mesirut, M-E-S-I-R-U-T, second word, nefesh, right? M-E-S-M-E-S-I-R-U-T, Mesirut. Second word, nefesh, N-E-F-E-S-H. N-E-F-E-S-H, thank you. Mesirut nefesh, which is Mesirut, I'm willing to give over nefesh, my life. And he said, if you don't do that practice every day, you're already dead. That's our practice today, right? What am I willing? And then I can rejoice, right? Then I can rejoice, right? Wow, then I can rejoice. And I just want to just look at the last clip, right? It's a 1 minute clip of soldiers today in Kiev, right? Who in the middle of all of this are dancing and celebrating because all of a sudden I'm alive, right? So let's take a look at that clip. Right? When I know what I'm willing to die for, right, I'm alive for the first time. So friends, Let's close with our code. Let's take a look at our code. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. But what does God need from me at all times, and especially right now? God needs me to pray. So we're going to close with prayer, and next week we're going to spend next week talking about what is prayer in the Ukraine. Right, but I want to talk just as we finish the last minute. God needs me to partner. We've talked about that. I've got to partner and actually commit my outrageous acts of love. God needs me to be God. What does that mean? Right? God needs me to be an atheist. So Nachman of Breslov, a great Hasidic master, writes that actually atheism is manifest in reality because at times we have to behave as if we are the only God in the world. And when something needs doing, we have to do it. We don't wait for God to do it. If I see a poor person, I don't say, God made that person poor. And if the news story has to be told, we don't say God's going to cause some people to put it together. It's mine to do. An atheist means I'm not reliant on the caricature of the cosmic vending machine God who's going to get it done. Like God actually lives in me. Okay, wow. Right? God needs him to be human. Meaning I'm not just God, I'm also human. I'm actually fragile. I'm filled with uncertainty. And I don't actually create fascistic absolute certainties. I dance in the uncertainty and I hold my certainty and uncertainty together. God needs me to cry. To actually cry, to be able to actually fully cry. Tears of unbearable pain, outrageous pain, but also tears of outrageous love. God needs me to laugh. Right? Laugh, meaning there I am today in Kiev, and I'm celebrating, I'm laughing. Because it's only laughter that holds the paradox. It's only laughter that nullifies tyranny. It's only laughter that brings down, right, oppression. Okay? I've got to do all of it. God needs me to trust. God needs me to trust that I'm participating in a cosmoerotic universe. That reductive materialism is actually not accurate. We actually live in a reality which is a love story. And there's an enormous amount of information to justify, to tell us with absolute certainty reality is a love story. And yet, I hold the void in which I can't find God, and I become God in that void, and I do both of them together. I know it's a love story. I trust that it's a love story. And I trust that she's trusting me, right? To speak of your love in the morning and to trust you through the night, right? I turn to reality and I say, I speak of your love in the morning, but I trust you through the night. And then reality sings back to me, and these are the words of Solomon, to speak of your love in the morning, and God says, and I trust you, human being, through the night. And all of it together, okay? Wow, so we're gonna close with one chant, and then Krista, right, is gonna tell us just how to get involved in it. And how to join in, and how to be, okay? Right, so here's the chant. So Krista, can you give us just Amor? Give us Amor as a chant, right? And Amor is this chant of, right, its insides are aligned with love. Love is what reality is, right? It's my joyous obligation to be God. And it's my joyous obligation to be a human being. So take us inside.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you. I want to begin with just feeling the tenderness of this moment, the tenderness of this amazing, beautiful pleasure to stand for a cause together. And then we're going to blow it open in fierce power.
Amor.
Tell us how to join love. How do we get involved?
And as always, we will end today bringing everyone on our beautiful faces. So please wait for that beautiful moment at the end of this broadcast. But right now, I want to invite all of us from this place of tenderness, from this place of our hearts being blown open. I don't know about you, but I feel completely activated, alive, and filled with power and love to step in, to stand for this cause, to stand for this new story of outrageous love in the world. And we are all invited to participate in this unique self-symphony for a planetary awakening in love. So that's exciting. So how can you join? I'm just going to show you our website so you know where to find everything. If you go to onemountainmanypaths.org, first of all, if you haven't signed up yet, if you're looking at this live stream on Facebook or YouTube, on the homepage, you can register, and then I will send you every week the link to the Zoom call. That's where our community gathers. That's where you can meet each other in the chat box. So you're welcome there. And then next to that, if you click here on resources, that's where you can find, for example, all the books here. You can also find here a new page called Don't Look Up. We did a beautiful series on Don't Look Up, on responding to existential risk. So here you can find that beautiful page. And this is also a great thing to share with your friends, to show them what we are all about and to invite them to the next week of One Mountain. If you click here on events, you will see a new dialogue that is coming up on the 7th of April, a dialogue with Dr. Marc Gafni and Andrew Cohen. So you're welcome to join there as well. And right here under partnership is where you can read all about becoming a member of One Mountain. And you can choose your own contribution, but please give as much as you can, as I know that we all do. It already starts from $25 a month, but we encourage everyone to give $100 a month if that is a possibility for you. If you join as a member of One Mountain, you will get access to these 9 deep, 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 beautiful courses. And we also have study groups together. Right now, we're studying together the 11th hour, but at the end of April, I think April 23rd, we will start a new study group called God is Eros. That's a beautiful way to step in, to meet other members, to embody the Dharma and to become the Dharma. And then last, I just want to share also the invitation to come to the Outrageous Love Festival that is happening every summer in Europe. This year it's in Belgium, and it's an 7-day immersion into the Dharma. It's a retreat. It's a mystery school. It's a beautiful place to be. You can come to Europe to participate in person, but you can also join online. So maybe someone can share also the link to that in the chat box. And now I want to invite all of us to dance, to blow it out, to embody this beautiful, beautiful day that we have together. So we're going to close. We're going to bring your face on the screen. If you are up for that, please click OK as soon as we invite you to up level as a panelist. And then you can turn on your video. And Kristina, I'm going to ask you to play our revolutionary song, We Are the People. So let's get up, let's dance, and let's blow it out together. Thank you so much. People.